Shostakovich wrote two cello concertos. The first one is done a lot because it really features the cello as a virtuosic showpiece type of an instrument. The second concerto, as with the first, written for Mstislav Rostropovich, 7 years after the first one was in 1959, this one's 1966. It was for the 60th birthday celebration of Shostakovich. But the piece began as some kind of a symphony, and you'll hear at the very beginning just these solo murmurings from the cello. The piece actually begins and ends with the cello all by itself. It's not your typical concerto in any way. Now, I will say that it does require a virtuosic performance from the cellist, but it's not the same kind of showpiece that you would expect from a concerto. The first movement is quite long, and it begins just with solo strings for a very, very long time, and gradually it begins to pick up some energy. Everything is based on these first two tones that the cellist plays, just this falling half step, which then he does again. And then when the woodwinds pick it up, they do the same thing. It's always this kind of this sigh that goes. So the first movement is quite long. The second movement is like a short march. And supposedly it's based on this folk song, "Pretzels, buy my pretzels," that Shostakovich heard in the streets. And he liked it so much that he decided to put it in. I think it's kind of an inside joke between he and Slava Rostropovich. So he put that in. It's a very short interlude in between the much longer first and third movements. And just so you know, the second movement segues directly into the third movement. You'll know because it's this brilliant fanfare for two solo horns and the snare drum. It's also unusual in that our cellist, Zachary Steers, has lots of duets with percussion. Sometimes it's just him and a bass drum. Sometimes just cello and a snare drum. Sometimes just cello and a tambourine. And the piece ends just with cello and percussion, much like his last symphony, Symphony number 15. So really, this is a concerto in name only. It's really a symphony for cello and orchestra. And here to play it, the marvelous, very gifted Zachary Steers.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I'm often asked, what's the difference between a philharmonic, a symphony, and an orchestra? Philadelphia Orchestra, New York Philharmonic, Cleveland Orchestra, San Francisco Symphony. There's no difference. They're all the same. It's all in a name. It's just like, you wouldn't say Philadelphia and Philharmonic because there's too many PHs in it, right? Better for chemists than for composers. Also, I'm asked, what makes a symphony a symphony? And starting already with Haydn, with Mozart, particularly with Beethoven, with Brahms, and certainly with Tchaikovsky, what great composers like to do in their symphonies, and Shostakovich does this as well, is they like to take a seed and build upon it. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to have the orchestra play three different small little four-note excerpts, which, even if we didn't do this, Tchaikovsky would work on your subconscious by doing this. So the symphony begins with the basses, the intone, this little fifth, and then Morgan, our principal bassoonist, plays these four notes. Of course, that grows into something much bigger. But then, those four notes become this in the violas and the celli. Which is very different music, and yet it's still built on the same idea, just as when the first violins start going crazy in the middle of the development section with this fugato motif. It's the same idea. But you don't necessarily hear that as all part of the same. It all sounds fresh. That's what makes Tchaikovsky so great, is that he takes the same material and keeps reintroducing it, making it sound new, when in fact it's all built on the same seed. The second movement, I call it a limping waltz, because it's not really in three, it's in five. So it's like one, two, three, whoops, one, two, three, whoops. It's like he's a little bit, and yet it still has all the charm that you would expect in any Tchaikovsky dance. I mean, this is, after all, the composer of Nutcracker, Sleeping Beauty, Swan Lake, all these wonderful tunes that you all know and we all love. The third movement is the most popular movement. It's a march. And this is the problem and the challenge for you. Because at the time that this was written, in 1893, many of the Russians who heard this for the first time thought, well, why didn't Tchaikovsky end the symphony with the march, the brilliant march? Because it's the only movement where Tchaikovsky is begging for you to applaud. Of course, we're all taught, don't applaud between movements. Well, hogwash, right? If you want to applaud for the third movement, go ahead. But only if you collectively believe we were worthy of your applause, right? We will be. But the problem with it is that once you do that, it takes us then a moment to gather ourselves for the last movement, which is a lament. It's a real lament. I mean, you can even hear the way the trombones and tuba take us from this to this to this. You can just see it. You can hear the eulogy. You can hear the laying of the body. You can hear the body finally at rest. Although Tchaikovsky insisted there was no program to this symphony. And yet, 8 days after the premiere of this symphony, he drank unboiled water and died of cholera. And so, when I was a student, it was commonly believed that this was Tchaikovsky's suicide symphony. It was his requiem, as if he knew that he was going to die. We now know that not to be true. And yet, this symphony, the way it ends. I mean, it's like we think that Mahler's Ninth is so great because of the way it ends. Tchaikovsky did it before him with this symphony. It's very daring. It's very courageous of him to end a symphony with a lament. It had never been done before. It's really an extraordinary symphony. And it's really the only time in my 10 years that a number of these students have come up to me and said, thank you for doing this. We hope you like it too. Tchaikovsky Symphony number 6. I will just say one more note. The pathétique, please don't read it as we do, as pathetic. Pathétique, it's really a word that Tchaikovsky's brother, Modeste, thought would be a good title for it after the premiere in late October of 1893. We should hear pathétique more as infused with pathos. And as you hear the symphony, it will become very evident to you. Tchaikovsky, Symphony No. 6, Pathétique.